Can you see the slide now?
Yeah, we can see, it clearly.
Okay, okay.
So let us start now. So good afternoon, everybody. I request Professor Gopal Das, the head Department of Chemistry, to please give an introduction to the speakers today, and then we can start. And as mentioned earlier, this is going to be live telecast also on YouTube. So all audiences on the YouTube, we also welcome you. And whatever questions you have, you please write it down on the sidebar that you have. And your questions will be, asked by one of our members. So with this, I hand over the mic to Gopal. Gopal, please go ahead and introduce the speakers, please.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Balan. So good afternoon to all the participants and all the viewers in the YouTube. So in this series of lectures by CRSI Northeast chapter, so first lecture we will. All welcome, Professor Ajay Ghosh, the Director of CSIR Institute, NIST, National Institute of Industrial Science and Technology. He is also a Professor and Dean of Chemical Sciences of the Academy of Scientific and Innovative Research. His primary research focus is the organic photoresponsive materials and supramolecular chemistry, molecular cell assembly, and gelers and sensors. And his research contributions in it's been recognized by various prestigious awards, and among them is the 2007 Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award for Chemical Sciences. 2012, he is the first chemist to got the Infosys Science Prize, and 2013 Silver Medal for Chemical Research Society of India. 2013 again, the Third World Academy of Science Prize for Chemistry, and 2015. The Jesse Bose prestigious Jesse Bose National Fellowship Award. He has published more than 160 research articles, few book chapters, and he has several patents in his name and 25 PhD students. And mostly important is that his publications are cited over to more than 12,000 times. And he is also a fellow of most of the scientific academic societies of India. Along with that, he is an honorary fellow of Kerala Academy of Science. He is a fellow of the Third World Academy of Science. And he, from 2013, he has been serving as an editor and as an editorial board in several prestigious journal of RSC and other Elsevier and science, all other publication society. So with this, I welcome Professor Ajay Ghosh in this lecture series. In a series of CSIR Northeast chapter.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, okay. Good. So, thank you very much for the kind words of introduction. And also, I thank you all for inviting me for this webinar series. Which I understand mainly to celebrate the Chemistry Week, jointly organized by IIT Guwahati and the Chemical Research Society of India. When Dr. Iyer contacted me a few days back about this program, he said that the audience will be a kind of general audience. There will be a lot of students. So it would be nice if I can talk a little bit in general so that the broad audience can appreciate the topic well. So therefore, I have decided to speak a little bit in general. So that is the reason I have given a title like this, The Chemistry of Constructing Supramolecular Functional Materials. But before I go to the topic, I would also greet you and also send our appreciation and from our institute, most welcome all of you whenever there is a chance, whenever you come to the southernmost part of India, Kerala, maybe after this pandemic, you are most welcome. So I'm sending the greetings of all my colleagues from CSIR NIST, which is a CSIR laboratory at Trivandrum. So this laboratory is, not a big laboratory, but a medium-sized laboratory. We have around 80 scientists and 300 students, and then we have a group of technicians and administrative people, around totally 500 people in this institute working on interdisciplinary activities. We have mainly 5 active R&D divisions, and the center is actually the chemical sciences and technology. And so this division is connected with 4 other active R&D divisions, one on agro-processing technology, other on material science and technology, environmental technology, and microbial process and technology. In all these 5 divisions, there are a lot of cross-disciplinary research happening. And this laboratory is known for quality scientific research and also translational research. In this institute, I belong to the Chemical Science and Technology Division. Apart from my job as the director of the institute for overall management, but still I do a lot of research with my own research group. And for the past several years, one of my research interests, which is very close to my heart, is on soft organic materials, mainly molecular self-assembly, supramolecular chemistry and all. So this is actually a symbol of my research group, AG. My students and my colleagues, co-workers, and very fondly call me AG, Ajay Ghosh. And so what you see here is my age, 58. And this is my active area of independent research, 32. So don't misunderstand, this is silver 58, 32. Huh? This is my group representation. Okay, so in this research group, we mainly work with Pi systems. You know Pi systems, they are active components of the so-called organic electronic devices by virtue of the free pi electron systems, delocalized pi electron system available. These kind of molecules have a lot of properties, mainly optical properties. Therefore, these molecules are widely used for electronic applications and also photonic applications. And therefore, it is important to understand the behavior of these kind of molecular systems when they are put it in solvent or when they are put it on a substrate, how they behave, how they interact with each other. Because these interactions will have a decisive role in the overall properties, electronic properties, when it is put it on a device. Therefore, a deep understanding is very, very essential. So, in many cases, people use polymers, and some cases oligomers, and also some cases small molecules. So I'm now going to address the small molecular systems because it is easy to have in-depth study with small systems because you can structurally characterize them very well. You can easily process them. So therefore, we are interested in working with small Pi systems, but at the same time, these Pi systems are functionalized with different kinds of functional groups. Because in organic chemistry, functional groups are so powerful. and the functional group decide the properties of the molecules and then the materials which are formed out of these molecules. So now with Pi systems, we work on different aspects, small domains of Pi systems, and we use them as building blocks for making molecular assemblies, soft materials like gels, particularly organogels. We make a lot of stimuli responsive materials out of these systems. We also make coordination polymers with metal and otherwise. Then we also make covalent organic frameworks. We use them as molecular probes and sensors because Pi systems are highly sensitive to their surrounding media. And they are very strongly colored. They have fluorescence. So all these properties are very, very appropriate for making different kinds of materials. And some of these things have been summarized in some of our recent reviews. For example, in 2014, we have a chemical review written. Then there is a small article in Science. And then very recently this year, early this year, there is an account in Accounts of Chemical Research. So those students and researchers who are interested to know more about these activities and these areas in general, you can go through some of these references. Now, I would also like to mention here that what I'm going to present today, a small portion of what we have done so far, is mainly the contribution of these people that you see now. So therefore, it is my duty and responsibility and also great pleasure in acknowledging the contributions of all these my former PhD students and collaborators. Most of them have graduated from my group and they are working elsewhere. Some of them are in permanent positions. Some of them are in temporary positions. Some of them are doing postdoc, both in India and also in abroad. And many of you may know many of them. So I'm not going to describe each one of them. But what I wanted to tell you is that this what we have achieved so far is a collective hard work and commitment and intellectual contribution of all these people. Okay, so it is the nice opportunity for me to introduce all of them to all of you. Okay, now let me also say something about the National Chemistry Week. Probably all of you know that we are celebrating the National Chemistry Week, and this lecture series is a part of this celebration. And you know, National Chemistry Week is a community-based program of the American Chemical Society. It was originally started by the American Chemical Society, and this is an annual event with the ACS local chapters, local sections, and students' chapters, their technical divisions, their business wing, schools, and individuals, with the purpose of propagating the importance of chemistry in daily life, mainly the communicating the importance of chemistry to the general, the common man, and to convince them that chemistry plays an important role in our daily life. And as part of this, in our country also, we celebrate, especially the Chemical Research Society is taking the lead in celebrating the National Chemistry Week during the first week of November. And throughout the country, under the aegis of the Chemical Research Society, we celebrate the National Chemistry Week. And a few days from now, I'm going to give another lecture which is organized by the Chennai CRSI chapter. Okay, so it is always a pleasure in associating with the Chemical Research Society and various local chapters and institutions like IITs for giving this kind of talks and also interacting with the large number of students with the view of motivating them, encouraging them to come more and more vibrantly in the field of chemistry. So this year, the theme of the National Chemistry Week celebration is sticking with chemistry. Every year they have a theme. If you go through the website, you will see that there are many, many different themes suggested for the Chemistry Week celebrations. So this week it is sticking with chemistry. That is mainly the chemistry of, glues and, that kind of materials. But, you know, I would also like to tell you something about another, day of celebrations, that is the Mold Day. Now, probably many of you know that every year we celebrate Mold Day. Actually, the Mold Day is celebrated by chemists across the globe annually from 6.02 a.m. to 6.02 p.m. on October 23rd every year, mainly to commemorate Avogadro's number, 6.022 into 10 to the power of 23, which is the number of atoms in exactly 12 grams of carbon 12. That is one mole of carbon 12. And this was founded by the National Mold Day Foundation on 15th May 1991. So this also we celebrate. And then this year, there is another important event, celebrations happening across the world. That is on because this year is 100 years of macromolecular science. And a lot of things happened in this country as well in the field of macromolecules. In fact, I also gave a few lectures in different places to celebrate the 100 years of macromolecular science. This is, to commemorate the landmark paper published in 1920 by Schrodinger, who proposed that rubber and other materials such as starch, cellulose, and proteins are long chains of short repeating units linked by covalent bonds. That was actually at the birth of a new era of materials in the field of chemistry. That is the macromolecular chemistry or the macromolecular science in general, which is postulated by Professor Hermann Staudinger. I'm just telling all this for the information of the students. Probably all of you may be aware, but I thought I should mention this so that those who forgot some of these things will come to know about this. Now let me take all of you to a different world, entirely different from science. Because, you may wonder why I'm showing this slide here. This is something about creativity and innovation in art. I thought of showing this slide, just to cheer you up a little bit. Because, science is, after all, it is creativity. And in every creativity, there is an art. So you can say the art of creating science, or the art of synthesizing molecules, the art of making new materials. Okay, so science is also an art. But now I'm talking about pure art. So what you see is one of the monumental, creation of, an artist. This is the most celebrated artistic work ever created in the history of mankind. This is the monumental piece that is Mona Lisa. This is created by Leonardo da Vinci, who lived in the year 14. The year is 1452, 1519. So I just wanted to tell you what is the difference between a pure art and a scientific art, or the art of doing science. Okay, so there is some clear differences. For example, to make an artwork like this, like Mona Lisa, the artist need many things, many raw materials. For example, in this case, you need a canvas, you need paints, you need brush, and then you need the creative mind with a lot of imagination, logical thinking, and then your ability to execute with certain kind of perfection. then only, you know, an art like this will, you know, will, you know, evolve. Okay. But now, if someone asks, you know, if Da Vinci is asked to make this, you know, piece of art once again, can he make it? The answer is yes, of course. Why can't? He can make it. But that may not be this Mona Lisa. It may be another Mona Lisa. Probably it may be better than this. Or it can be, you know, maybe even worse than this. But the fact is that probably it may be able to repeat. But then there will be something which will be missing in those kind of creations. And that is called the accuracy. Because you cannot accurately create with 100% perfection. That is the problem with an artistic creativity. But now I will show you another slide, which is probably can be an equivalent of this in science, particularly in chemistry. Okay, so this is an interesting slide for all chemists. The creativity and innovation in science. So I was talking about creativity and innovation in arts. And now this is an equivalent that you can think of in chemistry. And you see that this is the picture of one of the greatest chemists of all time. That is Professor Woodward, R.B. Woodward, who got Nobel Prize in the year 1965. For his overall contribution in the synthesis of many different kinds of natural products, particularly the one which is vitamin B12. Now, I am showing the structure of vitamin B12 on my right-hand side. Now, you look at the structural beauty, at the same time, the structural complexity of this molecule. If you look at, as a chemist, you know, you can think how complex is this natural product, natural molecule. There are several. Now there are even much complex molecules which are created by nature. Okay, and you must remember that this was synthesized way back in 1960s by Woodward and his research team. And, you know, he says more than 100 scientists, students and researchers worked for a few years to complete the synthesis of this particular natural product. Okay, and now here also, like what I told in the previous case, Da Vinci's Mona Lisa, here also you need certain raw materials. For us, what are these raw materials? For us, it is chemicals, solvents, few apparatus, maybe few instruments. These are our raw materials. And now we have to create molecules out of these raw materials. And now how we will create? Just like in the previous slide, here also we need a lot of imagination. Okay. Without imagination, you cannot do anything. You have to have imagination. Any crazy imagination that you can have, then you can create many crazy things, crazy materials. So here also you need imagination, you need logical thinking, how to make. And then once you arrive at some of these things, then it is the execution with some of the raw materials that we have. And the execution should be perfect. If it is not perfect, you will fail at many places. Even otherwise, you may fail. But if you have proper thinking, planning, and perfect execution, every likely that you will succeed. Okay? So all these things you need for making an art also. But then I said there is something different. And that difference is repetition. It is not only repetition. Repetition is possible in arts. But what I said is accuracy. That will be missing in artistic creation. But in science, you cannot miss that. Okay, if you miss that component, then your science is not science, it is wrong. So this is the most important thing. I am telling this for the students, those who are practicing science, those who are practicing research. And you must remember, there are many, many things that you should practice, you should follow while you are learning science, while you are doing science. That is a scientific ethics. I'm underlining this point because today there are a lot of issues we hear here and there in many places on, you know, plagiarism, malpractices, copying, all kind of stuff. But this should not happen in science. So every student, it is your responsibility, and supervisors like me, it is our responsibility to make sure that what we are doing is correct, what we are reporting is correct, what we are saying is possible to repeat by a third party at a different location. So I was trying to put across you the difference between art and science. I hope you enjoyed it and you understood what I mean in every sense. Now, I'll slowly take you to the subject. Okay. Now I was talking about art, then the art of making science or doing science. And now when you talk about art of doing science, one of the best domain that I can present before you is the supramolecular chemistry, the domain of the so-called supramolecular chemistry, which is something called chemistry beyond molecules, according to the famous scientist Professor Jomery Lane. So it was actually Jomery Lane's idea. The term was introduced maybe four decades ago by Jomery Lane. In fact, after his Nobel Prize in molecular recognition. And here again, I am showing this theme of this year's Chemistry Week, sticky chemistry or sticking with chemistry. And so now I can connect this theme with supramolecular chemistry, because supramolecular chemistry plays an important role in the world of sticky chemistry, or in the world of glues and similar kind of materials. Okay. Now, to talk about sticky materials or sticky chemistry or glues and adhesives, you have to think in terms of polymer chemistry, because many of these glues and adhesives you can see, you can buy them, they are polymers. They are commercially available. They are very permanent, strongly bonding materials, which help two materials to bond together. Can be the same kind of materials or different kind of materials. For example, glass and metal, or metal and metal, or glass and glass, or glass and wood, anything. Okay. Now, supramolecular chemistry can also make such kind of sticky materials or glues or adhesives. But now I'm going to combine these two terms, that is polymers and supramolecular chemistry. Now we are introducing a new term, the so-called supramolecular polymers, which is again a subdomain of supramolecular chemistry or the world of soft materials or gels, or so on and so forth. Okay, so this is nothing but the chemistry of non-covalent interaction. Okay. There are many different kinds of non-covalent interactions. And some of the most familiar for chemists are, of course, hydrogen bonding. Then other interactions like pi interactions. Then weak van der Waals interactions. There are so many such interactions. And these weak interactions can hold the molecules together. So in a way, we can say that hydrogen bonding is a strong glue for chemists for putting molecules together to create different kinds of supramolecular architectures. And this is the art of making such structures. And so what I have shown here is some different kinds of supramolecular systems which are metal coordination, based on metal coordination boards, multiple hydrogen bonds, host-guest interactions, donor-acceptor interactions, dipolar interactions, etc. So now, when we talk about sticky materials, glues and adhesives, you can now invoke a lot of supramolecular chemistry and non-covalent interactions, and you can use these interactions creating, you know, dynamic supramolecular system or dynamic glues, which are reversible. Some of the polymeric glues that you see, they are very permanent. Once you stick, you cannot take them out. You cannot separate them because they are permanent glues or permanent adhesives. But suppose you want to remove it after some time. You need a strong glue, but it should be, you know, separable after some time. So it should be reversible with the help of some external energy. For example, it can be heating, or it can be some other mechanical force or something, should be able to take it out. That kind of glues, which are not permanent, have a lot of applications. And you know, these kind of glues, for example, bio glues, bioadhesives, they are widely used in surgical applications, dental applications. There are so many applications. So this topic is very interesting, where a lot of chemistry, lot of polymer chemistry, lot of supramolecular chemistry, all are involved, depending upon what kind of materials, what kind of applications that you are going to use. Okay? And when you talk about these kind of materials, there are a lot of examples from nature. Nature has created everything for us. Most of them are marvelous creations. There are a lot of structural beauty, at the same time, you know, complexity in those creations. Look at all different kinds of animals, birds, flowers, the dynamic colors of, many different kinds of butterflies. There are a lot of chemistry, science, engineering, creativity behind all this. And most of the time, material scientists, chemists, physicists, all of us try to understand how nature create these kind of architectures and see whether our knowledge of science, for example, for us, chemistry, whether this knowledge can be used to recreate some of these natural creations. So that is called the biomimetic science or biomimetic chemistry. So in the chemistry of glue also, there are not of natural examples. For example, you might have heard of mussels. The mussel inspired super glue. You can see that, when you go to a beach or in a backwater area, you can see these kind of shells or mussels which are sticking on some kind of substrate or rocks or wood, which are very difficult to take it out. They are very strongly bonded. These kind of glues have a lot of applications, especially, as I said earlier, in surgical applications, in dental applications, and so many other applications. Okay, so there are a lot of chemistry, even supramolecular chemistry plays an important role now making such artificial glues. And now let me come more to the chemistry side now. So what are supramolecular polymers? Supramolecular polymers are actually a kind of an aggregation of, or an arrangement of functional monomers, not through permanent covalent bond, but through reversible non-covalent interactions. So what you see here in this is there are two different kinds of systems which are complementarily interacting. They are complementarily interacting molecular systems. You can say that they recognize each other and form a kind of linear supramolecular chain, which is now can be similar to a permanent, polymeric structure. And then you can think of different kinds of such monomers. For example, these are two different chains having, complementary sites. They come together to form a network of structures. These are like, network polymers or cross-linked supramolecular polymers. By changing the nature of these polymerizations, for example, from linear to you know, cross-linked or supramolecular, or from one-dimensional to two-dimensional to three-dimensional, you can control their properties. And also by arranging the monomers in different fashion, for example, like in other polymers, alternate polymers, random sequence, block polymers, or blended polymers, you can now do all kinds of, you know, the traditional practices in supramolecular chemistry and try to make different kinds of materials with different kinds of properties. But the difference between the traditional polymer chemistry and the supramolecular polymer chemistry is that in supramolecular polymers, the system is highly dynamic. So this is dynamic chemistry. They are dynamic materials. Their properties can be reversibly controlled with the help of an external stimulus. And now, when you talk about these kind of interactions, you know, you can think of different kinds of interactions, you know. And when you want to make polymers, actually, you need very strong interactions. That is, you need multiple hydrogen bonds. And multiple hydrogen bonds are of different types. You can use different functionalities, complementary interacting functionalities to create this. And usually when the number of hydrogen bond increases, the stability should increase with the number of the hydrogen bonding. But not always. There can be exceptions. For example, when you take a multiple hydrogen bonded system, there can be primary hydrogen bond and also there can be secondary hydrogen bond interactions. And these secondary hydrogen bonding can be sometimes repulsive and sometimes attractive. Now, see, for example, you take this system, okay, which has an association constant of 10 to the power of 2, and you can see the hydrogen bonding site here. You can now name it like in a pictorial form like this, where you have a hydrogen bond acceptor, hydrogen bond donor and acceptor. Because you take this molecule, I hope you can, all of you can see this. This is a hydrogen bond acceptor because that lone pair and the oxygen can accept a hydrogen bond. There is a NH here, which is a donor. Again, an oxygen with a lone pair of electrons, which is a hydrogen bond acceptor. So you can represent this side as acceptor, donor, donor. On the other side, you can have donor, acceptor, acceptor. And now there are three primary interactions you can see. But now if you take the secondary interaction, you can see the cross interactions are donor, donor, acceptor, acceptor. These are repulsive interactions. And these repulsive interactions actually destabilizes the hydrogen bond. Okay. And if you minimize this repulsive interaction, for example, if you choose this system, then you can see only one repulsive interaction and the rest is an attractive interaction in addition to the primary, three primary hydrogen bond. So the stability will increase. Now in this system where you have all attractive interactions, there is no repulsive interaction, the stability further increases. So you can tune the stability from 10 to the power of 2 to the 10 to the power of 4 to 10 to the power of 5. Okay. So see, these are some of the very fundamentals. And as I mentioned, you know, this is mainly for the sake of the students who are maybe in the graduate level or the undergraduate level. And probably it may be also useful some of the people who are doing even you know, research. Okay, so you can now take the most appropriate functional group through the logical thinking that you have, and then you can use them for making different kinds of structures. So I was talking about the stability of this hydrogen bond, repulsive forces and attractive forces, and the number of repulsive and the number of attractive, the net interaction is the one which is deciding the overall stability, the association constant of these kind of systems. And this is something called a Jorgensen model, which is talking about the stability of hydrogen bonded assemblies. So if you really want to make a stable hydrogen bonded assemblies, you should know all these factors. How many primary interacting sites are there in the molecule? How many donor sites are there? How many acceptor sites are there? How the donor acceptor sites can be arranged? And how you can minimize the repulsive interactions, how you can enhance the attractive interactions. So all these things are very, very important when you do a design, an art of a molecular architecture creation. Okay. Now, for making, you know, glues and this kind of reversible supramolecular polymers, you need appropriate monomers. You can use this strong multiple hydrogen bonding motif, which forms stable hydrogen bond. the association constant should be more than 10 to the power of 5, then only you can make very stable hydrogen bonded supramolecular system. So this is one of the early example which is reported by Matt Meyer from Eindhoven. And he has used the uridine pyrimidine triple bonded hydrogen bonding assembly to create these kind of. So this is the hydrogen bond involved. And when you have these kind of, so this is a kind of a pre-polymer system which is now connected, functionalized through this hydrogen bonding moiety. They can complementarily interact, as you can see here. So they form complementary sites and then they polymerize. Okay, and then you can make something like this, an elastic solid, which is more or less similar to some of the, you know, traditional covalent polymers. Though their strength is as good as, because they have very, very strong hydrogen bond. Now, the beauty of this system over the permanent polymer system is that now you can apply some force. For example, you can heat and break the hydrogen bond, so you can bring back the monomer without decomposing the monomer. You know, this is one of the greatest difficulties of recycling traditional polymers. For recycling, you have to melt. And many a times when you melt it, the monomer is likely to decompose. That will generate a lot of toxic vapors, such as dioxins and many other polyaromatic hydrocarbons and many other toxics. But in this case, maybe without decomposing the monomer, by applying the right amount of energy, you can get back the monomer, and then you can do it any number of times. You can make the polymer, break the polymer, you can mold it in different shape, you can break it. So you can play around with this. So you can have a reusable, recyclable kind of polymers. So there are a lot of human scope for, but still finding such a supramolecular polymer which can replace the commodity polymers with such a strong, you know, property is still far away from reality. Okay. Now, with this kind of a you know, very general idea about the supramolecular chemistry or the world of chemistry beyond molecule, I may have a few more minutes to go, maybe another 10 minutes, Dr. Iyer.
Approximately 6 to 7 minutes, I think.
Okay. So the rest of the minutes, I will talk a little bit about our specific activity research on this particular area. I was talking weak interactions like hydrogen bonding, pi stacking, van der Waals interactions, dipolar interactions, and through these interactions, it can form different kinds of supramolecular architectures of different size and shape. Okay, you see a series of publications, throughout this slide, which are, based on these, research what we have done in the past maybe 20 years or so in my research group. I'm showing this not to showcase what we have done. Rather, my purpose of showing this slide with all these kind of publication is to motivate the young students who are doing research, going for high quality publications and publish more and more as much as you can, because we need more and publications to stay in the international, scientific arena. We need publications, strong publications, quality publications. At the same time, of course, people may ask, what is the use of all these publications unless and until there is some use? Of course, we should also think of that. At the end of the day, some of these things should be translated into some products or some applications where the common man can also enjoy the fruit of doing science. But some of the challenges and the scope of doing these things. So this is an emerging area, that is living supramolecular polymerization. Just like in other living polymerization, where you can have precise control on the length of the molecular chain, that is the molecular weight. If you want to make narrow dispersed polymers with well-defined properties, you have to have this is perfection that I was talking about. So you should be able to stop the chain at your will. So that is also possible in supramolecular polymerization. And why I am underlining is that there is a general concept that supramolecular polymerization is a spontaneous process So it can go, you know, beyond control most of the time. No, you can also do it in a controlled fashion. And so those who are interested can read, and but now there are many related articles in the literature available. Okay. Now, when we talk about control, there are many things. For example, controlling the size of your molecular chain or the molecular architecture. And size means what? Length, width, or dimension. Then controlling the shape of your supramolecular architectures. Shape means the morphology, and morphology means zero dimensional, one dimensional, two dimensional, spherical, linear, circular. Okay. Then of course properties. By controlling the size and shape, you are controlling the properties. Just like in metal semiconductors, you know that when the size decreases, the property changes. Okay. So like that, here also, when you control the size and shape of your supramolecular architectures, you can change the properties. What are these properties? Molecular properties. It can be optical properties. It can be electronic properties, like conductivity or charge transport. Then it can be like wettability, or response to different kinds of stimulus, that is stimuli responsive properties. So all these kind of materials have a lot of applications, wide ranging, tremendous applications in many areas of material science. Okay, so now I will take one specific aspect, that is the stimulus responsive materials or stimuli responsive materials. Okay, so when you talk about stimuli responsive materials, that is a material which respond to an external force or an external stimulus. What are these external stimulus? Can be light. Light is considered to be a precise external stimulus. Can be temperature. Can be a solvent. Can be an ultrasound. Can be a magnetic field. Okay, or it can be a mechanical force. There are many, many such external stimulus. So when the materials respond to such an external stimulus, you can then have control on the properties of these materials. And they have a lot of applications. Okay. I'll show you a few examples from our own research. I'm not talking in depth on any of these things. Rather, I will just flash, just to give you a kind of feel of what are these kind of stimuli responsive materials that we are talking. So this is a supramolecular system, an organogel, which we prepared out of this. This is one of our favorite molecules. I don't know how many papers we have published out of these molecules by doing functional chemistry, by taking advantage of the power of functional group. So this molecule, pi system, it can undergo self-assembly because of hydrogen bonding, pi stacking, and van der Waals interactions. And if you put it in a monomer, for example, you see styrene. It dissolves in styrene, and then you can, polymerize it, form a very nice gel, which has a very strong green emission or a greenish yellow emission. Now you can take this polymer, this is the polymer, pale yellow polymer. You can redissolve in appropriate solvent. You can cast it on any surface. You can make some films. You can mold it. But this film has certain characteristic properties, which you can now control with some external stimulus. And here it is temperature. So this is a temperature sensitive supramolecular assembly. So initially, when you polymerize this molecule in styrene, you get a polymer like this, you make a coating over it. The color is a pale green color like this, where all the molecules are organized in a fashion. But if you heat this, then the hydrogen bond will be broken, the other weak interactions, everything will be broken, the molecules are free and they fall apart, and then free to move, and they disorganize, which will change the color. And now you can see it changes to blue, like this, what you see here. And now you can write something, because it is temperature sensitive. If you use a small temperature gun as pen, you can write over this here. Wherever you heat, the color will change from green to blue. So you can use for writing something which is visible only under an excitation source, because it is, based on fluorescence. So this is one example. Another example is a mechanoresponsive system, which is a relatively new paper which we published in 2017 in Chemical Science. This is based on a BODP system, difluoro boron diazide indazine. This is a well-known chromophore, a well-known dye which has a lot of application. They are strongly colored, they have strong fluorescence, and because of that, they are widely used both in material science as well as in biology. So we have designed a molecule. This is the designer molecule that we have, and it can polymerize. It can undergo supramolecular polymerization, one-dimensional polymerization through this amide hydrogen bond, and then there can be some weak other interactions of this body P moiety, and then there are long hydrocarbon chains which can enter into sort of, you know, interdigitations, and it form a material like this, and it form a gel. Okay. So if you take this molecule and make a thin film out of this, it has a yellowish green color. But when you apply a force at some part of this, for example, you shear it, then immediately the color changes to a kind of orange red from the light green or yellowish green. And you see a very strong band in the near infrared region. So this is before this green spectrum, and the red one is after shearing, that is applying a force. You see a new strong band in the NIR region. These kind of systems are very rare, especially molecules which are emitting in the near infrared region by the stimulus of an external force. They are very, very less. And it can also form a gel, and the gel, you shear it, it then the color changes to orange red. It has a bright, you know, red emission and a very strong emission in the near infrared. And this is another system, which is a chiral self-assembly. This can be used again, you know, when you apply a force, wherever you apply force, the color changes. So you can write something on, over it. But the importance of this one is that it is a self-recovering mechanochromic system, because it forms some kind of, you know, molecular arrangement, which can slowly come back to its original state when you keep it under the ambient conditions. So then it becomes a self-erasable, you know, system. Okay, so these are some of the examples on which I didn't talk much about their chemistry or their deeper science. But now before I conclude, I will show one example which I will talk maybe another 5 minutes in, with you know, a little bit of details. So this is a paper which we published last year in Journal of American Chemical Society. And this is on a supramolecular gel phase controlled Diels-Alderete reaction. Okay, and then the property of the materials that we get out of this. Okay, so many of you know that, you know, Diels-Alderete photocycloaddition is one of the well-known textbook reaction. And photocycloaddition in general, for example, photocycloaddition of anthracene. And this is a classical textbook chemistry. And most of the students, they know about this. For example, if you take anthracene and irradiate in appropriate solvent or in the crystal form, then it undergo, you know, the cycloaddition at the 9-10 position to form a dimer in the absence of oxygen. Okay, but in presence of oxygen, the oxygen will get added. Or if you have a dienophile, then it gets added across the diene. Okay, and you can get different kinds of products. But when this 9-10 position is substituted, then this reaction won't happen. Okay, this is a classical textbook chemistry. A lot of studies have done on this. And the, you know, actually the reactivity, you may ask why the 9-10 position is only active, why the other positions are not active. And this is explained based on the Clark's aromatic pi sextet rule. And you can read about this in the textbook. You know, it's based on the net energy of the system which is generated out of these cycloadditions. Okay, because when you do the cycloaddition, the 9-10 positions, it liberate two, you know, benzene unit having the lowest energy available among these systems. Okay, so you can read more and more about this, what is Clark's aromatic pi sextet rule and why this 9-10 position is active. I'm not talking much about all those things. But what I wanted to tell you is a very specific example, that is 9-phenyl anthracene photocycloaddition. And this chemistry is also well known in the literature. Light-induced 4+4 or 4+2 Diels-Alderete cycloaddition of 9-phenyl anthracene. So if you take this molecule and do a photocycle addition, then it is every likely chance of getting these four attacks in your reaction. So you get a reaction mixture. 4+4 are two products, that is 4+4 syn and 4+4 anti, and 4+2 anti and 4+2 syn. So it will be always a mixture. Now the challenge for a chemist is, can you control this chemistry? Can you make one isomer out of this? So naturally, you know, many people have made many attempts, and there is an attempt, fixing this molecule on a metal surface. Okay, you hook the metal, this molecule on a metal surface, and so that you can fix the geometry, so that the two androcene will come face to face. Okay, and then when it comes face to face, then you can do the 4+4 very specifically. Because for 4+2 to happen, one of the androcene should overlap with this triple bond here. But if both the androcene are exactly face to face, then you end up with 4+4. And also, depending upon the orientation of the androcene moiety, you can selectively have 4+4 syn or 4+4 anti. Okay. So there are many such reports. But what we thought is that whether supramolecular chemistry can be used as a constrained medium for giving some orientation to these monomers and then do specific photocycle addition. Okay, so we have designed a monomer like this. You can now see it's a very simple system. We have taken, this is the active part of the molecule, and then we introduce an amide bond for one-dimensional hydrogen bonding, and then long alkyl chains for van der Waals interactions and facilitating solubility in organic solvents. And now the question is how these molecules organize and whether the organization will help to get a specific product. Okay. And now we did a lot of studies, and before doing the photochemistry, we did a lot of studies to understand how this molecule organize. And we found that you dissolve it in a solvent, for example, toluene, and then you ultrasonicate, then it immediately form a soft material, it form a gel in the solvent. And the gel you can characterize by several means. This is the rheology. Usually for a gel, you know, the G prime and G, you know, double prime, there should be a considerable difference, and there should be at least an one order of magnitude to have a viscoelastic property. So in this case, it shows nearly a one order of magnitude, indicating that this material is a viscoelastic material and it behaves like a gel. And now you can see from the microscopic analysis, this AFM and TEM analysis form like supramolecular tapes, and you can do all sorts of analysis, and then you can go in depth their morphological details. But the interesting thing is that you take this assembly gel and irradiate with 365 nanometer, then it becomes immediately a salt. It dissolves and becomes a solution, which means that the assembly is broken, the molecular arrangement is disturbed. And then you do the other routine analysis like viscosity or morphology. You can easily see that the morphology is very, very different. This is the TM image. This is before irradiation, it is a tape-like morphology, but after irradiation becomes like particles or spherical assembly, which means that it is disturbed. And no, so what is happening is this, initially the molecule is organized like this. Okay, these are one-dimensional supramolecular polymers, and then they interdigitate. And now it interdigitate in such a way that one of the androcene moiety comes almost, face to face with this triple bond, so that 4+2 cycloaddition is facilitated. Okay, and as a result, undergo 4+2 cycloaddition. And because of the steric hindrance of the photoproduct, the supramolecular assembly get disturbed and the molecule fall apart. And then you can, characterize the photoproduct. And now comes the twist of the whole study. Actually, my student Satyajit, he was thinking what to do with this. Okay, of course, we have done some chemistry. It is interesting. You can do specifically do 4+2. That is fine. But it is not enough if you are aiming for a high quality publications. You have to show something with this system. So he then studied the electroluminescence of these systems, both photoluminescence and electroluminescence. So with the help of a Japanese collaboration, Satyajit has made some organic light emitting diodes based on this initial molecule and with the photo product. And what is interesting is that the molecule before, you know, photocycle addition, that is the parent molecule, in the device, it shows a pale, blue emission, electroluminescence. But when he made a device out of this photo product, the cycloaddict, then surprisingly, he observed a white light emission, which was initially very, very difficult to explain. Why white light emission? Because you know that for white light, you should have the three fundamental colors, the RGB, red, green, blue. And the question is how some of these colors comes from a single molecule like this, because there is not too much of conjugation here. It is a little bit of sterically hindered systems, except one anthracene moiety and then benzene with a triple bond. There is no other chromophoric system which can emit at longer wavelength. But still, the device gives white light emission. So we have to do a lot of deeper studies to have an idea about this. And so this is some of the spectral details. So this is the photoluminescence. Photoluminescence is very clear that it is a blue emitting, material. Okay? Both EL and PL, both are almost the same, overlapping. But when you record the electroluminescence and photoluminescence with the photoaddict, then you see the photoluminescence is similar, more or less similar to the parent molecule. Okay, it is a pale blue in color, but the electroluminescence, you see a broad emission here, which is now blue, green, and red. So this is the reason why it appears white. Now the question is from where this part is coming. So we did still a lot of studies to understand. And finally, I'll come to the conclusion, the mechanism. The mechanism is that you have the emitter, we have the host electron injecting, and we have the anode and cathode. When you apply potential, what happens is that the host get excited and there is an electron transfer happening to the emitter. Okay, and then this species, the emitter radical anion and the host radical cation, okay? And they form a kind of an XC+, not XC plus, it is very different, it is called electroplex. It is like a counterpart of XC plus as you see in the photoexcited state. So this is something called electroplex, which forms only under an applied potential. And the electroplex is actually a complex between the host and the emitter, and that is the one which is emitting this red and a part of the green. Okay, and whereas the photoaddict, the excited photoaddict emit blue. So when you do the photo, cycloaddition, part of the molecule get converted to the photocycloaddict and part of the molecule will remain as such. And when you make a device out of this mixture, then you have the photoaddict and the starting compound. And when you apply potential in presence of the right, electron donor, system or host molecule, then you can give all these three fundamental colors, blue, green, and red, and the red comes from the electroplex. And this is a very unusual kind of situation. There are very few examples now known in the literature for these kind of systems. And because of this, the paper could be, published in JAX. Okay. Now I'm stopping at this point of time. So what I was trying to show you is that, starting from the very fundamentals of supramolecular chemistry, non-covalent chemistry, molecular interaction, host-guest interactions and all, you can design, beautiful supramolecular systems, not only with its architectural beauty, but at the same time, interesting functional properties. And you can make many different kinds of stimuli responsive materials, which can be used for a wide range of applications as sensors, as security materials, as fluorescent tag sensors. You can do a lot of chemistry with these kind of chemistry, which is the chemistry beyond molecule. So with this, once again I stop here, and once again I acknowledge all the contributions of my former associate students and collaborators and co-workers, and also some of the international collaborators for their contribution, and finally the funding agencies. So before I stop, once again it is my pleasure in thanking the organizers, particularly Dr. Iyer and other faculty members of IIT Guwahati and the local CRSI chapter of Guwahati. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Ajay Ghosh. It was a wonderful lecture, and I think you nicely introduced and explained several areas, especially the pipe-based gels, cycloaddition reactions, and especially their applications in stimulo-responsive materials, and ultimately the white light-emitting diodes. So, there are, I think, few questions, but one question a student has put up in the YouTube. I will go for that question first. Can I ask the question?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so this is, I'm reading it out. What is the feasibility and scope of small molecule based supramolecular self-assembly, co-assembly, disassembly, and their application in optical switching properties?
Okay, it's a very good questions, but a very naive question. It is very difficult to explain in a few lines, because such a broad area. But of course, the whole idea of supramolecular chemistry started maybe 4 decades ago as a simple laboratory curiosity. It started with molecules. It was a beautiful idea, imagination. You can see a lot of architectures in as a art, which I said in the beginning of my talk. That itself is something very exciting, especially for researchers, beginners, students, and all. When you see some structures with the help of a high-resolution microscope, the kind of joy that you can get out of this is always very exciting. But the purpose of having all these new areas and new research is that at the end of the day there should be some applications. Actually, for this kind of supramolecular system, many applications were envisioned at the very beginning. Some of them were materialized, some of them still, far away from reality. See, for example, one of the things I was talking about, that glue, reversible glue. Okay, you can use supramolecular chemistry in making reversible glue, which has a lot of surgical applications, as implant, and also in, dental application. There are so many such applications, and there are a lot of applications in toy making, different kinds of toys, because of the peculiar nature of some of these materials. Those things are especially with small molecules, for example, molecules which are derived out of sugar moieties, peptide moieties, and other conventional organic molecules. But when we talk about the pi system, they are a very different class of molecules. They are electronically active molecules where a lot of high-end applications like electronic, optoelectronic, and photonic applications. But in this domain, still a major breakthrough has not yet come. It is still awaiting that if someone can come up with a new idea of or new application for some of these systems, then that will be really fantastic. That is what I'm saying. There are still a lot of space available. Those who have a lot of ideas and innovative mind can do a lot of things with this. If you can come with a breakthrough, then there is nothing like that. So, for example, there are many photonic materials which can change colors, like the photonic crystals, like the butterfly wing. They are actually amazing kind of materials. There are many such examples available, but supramolecular chemistry. But one of the practical applications was making a kind of a very strong polymer which can be reused any number of times, and you can remold at any number of times without the monomer being degraded while it's reusable, reuse. So these are some of the applications. I hope I partly answered your question.
I think it was a long question, but I think you gave a good answer. So thank you very much. So in the interest of time, I think we won't take any further questions. Once again, on behalf of CRSI Northeast chapter, I would like to thank you. And, you know, it was a pleasure having you. I know you were very busy and we also gave an invitation a little bit late, but still you agreed. So thank you once again very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
So our next speaker today is Professor G.K. from IIT Bombay. So on behalf of CRSI Northeast chapter, I welcome you once again to this webinar series. My colleague, my CRSI Northeast convener, Professor Pradeep Phukan, is also here. So, and good evening to you also. Welcome once again. So, you know, I would like to briefly introduce Professor Lahiri now. Professor Gopal Das has a Viva Voce, so he has gone for conducting the Viva Voce exam. So, I will do that honors. So, Professor Lahiri has joined IIT Bombay in 1993 and has been a professor there since 2001. So, over the years, you know, he has got several medals and several awards. I'll just read the very latest ones. In 2016, he was awarded the CRSI Silver Medal. In 2016, he was also awarded the Institute Chair Professor. In 2016, he was also awarded the FNASC. And in 2019, he was awarded the Fellow of the Indian National Science Academy. In 2019, he was also awarded the J.C. Bose Fellowship. He has published more than 280 research papers and he works in a very wide area. I think, you know, I'll let him speak now rather than, you know, going through that area. Yes. So, Professor Lahiri, you can please start now.
Okay. Am I audible?
Yeah. Okay. Very clear.
Okay. So, let me begin with by expressing my appreciation to Professor Iyer for his kind invitation. I am delighted to be part of this chemistry celebration program. So we have heard a very wonderful talk by Professor Ghosh, mostly at the supramolecular site, lot of applications, etc. Now, being an inorganic chemist primarily, I would like to talk about the small molecules. Now, if you see my title a little bit carefully, then there are few items involved within the title itself. It essentially talks about the, you know, influence of redox, which is one of the fundamental items in chemistry at the interface of all the three branches, you know, what you could, or all branches what you could think about: organic, inorganic, physical, analytical. Its influence at the to tune the metal ligand cooperation in terms of its applications towards the molecular functionation. So many items are being clubbed together. But essentially, it talks about the redox behavior of the molecule and its influence in organic transformations or substrate activation, or we can talk about the chemical non-innocence of the substrates. Now, if
you... Can you make it full screen, Dr. Lahiri? Can you make it full screen?
I think so. It is full screen.
Once again, you can click on that full screen in your computer. Once more, you...
Okay. It is full screen.
No, we are not able to.
So, then what to do? I am using the full screen. This is going.
So, maybe you first, you know, click that enable editing. It's still showing.
Yeah. Let me try again. To that,
or in your computer, I think you can open as full screen first. Put it in the full screen and then go to the share. Open your PPT in the full screen.
Yeah, it is so.
And then go to the share mode.
it's the same problem, right?
Right now, we are not seeing our screen at all, actually. We don't see your screen.
Now, what I suggest is, first you open your PowerPoint in the full screen mode. MS Team.
I have been doing so.
When you put on the full screen, can you see your MS Team on the corner?
See, there was a thing called enable editing. Users enable that in the screen because, you know, that was showing up. When you opened up, you know, the enable editing was...
Where it is showing?
On the top, we saw that enable editing. You open the PowerPoint, on the top, you know, there is a strip. In the middle of that strip, it is showing, you know, you have to enable that editing.
No, PowerPoint, it is not showing so. Or I can send you the PowerPoint.
Yeah, you can send it to me. That is also fine.
Okay, just hold on. I need to have just a second. Let me open that. Yeah, I have sent you. Have you got it?
I'm checking.
I have already sent you.
Not yet, not received yet.
It has gone to you. You have not received, right?
Yeah, not received yet.
Oops.
Yeah, you just got it.
Got it, right?
Yes.
Okay.
So we will share it now and you can take control of that.
Yeah. So have you shared? Hello.
Yeah. We are sharing it. In a second, you should be seeing it.
Sure. What is the problem? I could not realize it so far.
Probably the enable editing thing, you know, that if you could have enabled that, I think it would have been okay.
Okay.
So what I do is that, you know, I open the PowerPoint and then go to the presentation mode in my computer.
Yeah.
Okay. And then you will see your, PowerPoint presentation in presentation mode. Yeah. And the corner, some corner, you will also see your, MS team.
Okay.
And then you click on the MS team and then start sharing. And then you will see your, computer.
I have been doing the same, but some of this MS team, with Zoom there is no problem. Only the MS team sometimes it creates some problem. But anyway, now it's fine.
Yeah, you can take control. You can click the request control, and then you will be operating it yourself.
No, where is the control is?
On the top you can see request control.
No, nothing is there. Request control, I got it.
Yes.
But it is not activated. It is not activated.
In that case, you can start and we will shift it for you. Okay, you can just tell next and we will shift it for you.
Okay, it's the full screen down, right?
Yeah. Now it's full screen. We can see it.
Okay. Go to the next slide. Yeah. Okay. Now, what I'm trying to convey through this thing, now, if we look at the, the inorganic chemistry or at the interface of inorganic, organic to catalysis, the most of the things happen at the, metal surface, where metal does not take part, in any electron transfer processes. Mostly it provides the necessary platform on top of which the organic transformations takes place. But a new concept has come up in last decades, what is called metal-ligand cooperativity. And metal-ligand cooperativity-based organic transformation, which has been observed to be much more efficient and effective compared to the classical concept of the catalysis. The reason behind it, that all metal-ligand-based molecular framework cannot function in that direction, that is only possible where both the metal and ligand can take part in the redox processes, and only a few selective class of organic molecules which could participate in the redox processes. And in that situations, the frontier orbital energy of metal ligand would driven very close to each other, and so that the electron shuttling at the interface is possible. So, and that essentially leads to the fact of your resonating form, as I have mentioned already, or the tautomeric form. Now, whatever it is, at the mononuclear level, if you consider, then it's very difficult to talk about the electronic structure in a very precise fashion. And most of the cases, you would be seeing that one intermediate description of the electronic structure would fit much better than the precise electronic structural forms. In a polynuclear setup, the concept would become much more difficult. Difficult in the sense where one could see that if we start talking about a, say, ligand bridge dinuclear setup, where one could see the one electron transfer process can take us to the mixed valence setup, where the neutral bridge being bridged between the two metal center having different oxidation states, or one could expect to have the radical bridge isovalence situation. Alternatively, one can think about the intramolecular electron transfer at the metal ligand interface, which talks about the RIET process, which is being very popular in recent times, which we have introduced decade ago. And there what you could see that two electron metal oxidation followed by or simultaneously one electron ligand reduction. Essentially, it is one electron oxidation at the metal side, and that is also equally true at the reverse side, that means reduction process as well. But this is the concept what you thought, which is acceptable or which is reasonable if it is a very precise consideration. But what happened, because of the orbital disposition and their energy parameters are such in such a class of molecules, where most of the cases, intermediate description fits much better than the any precise description. So we have been working in this area since last decades, and many issues have come up. And the major problem over here is that to draw the generality, one cannot make a general statement that this molecule or this molecular framework behaves this way, so it would also be extended to the next molecule. That requires the scrutiny at the individual level. So this is a very, I should say, unpredictable situation in most occasions. But by using, high-level experimental, results along with the theoretical background, one could make some reasonable conclusion about the electronic structural aspects. Now the next one, if we go to the next one, then what we try to, next one, please. Yeah. Now there are two parallel aspects as far as this chemistry is concerned. One aspect at the fundamental level, where one could think about how to describe the electronic structural aspects of that molecule by using experimental and theoretical considerations. And the second aspect, whether that concept of metal ligand cooperativity in terms of their redox could be utilized to analyze, their catalytic and functionalization impact. So let us give a couple of examples which would clarify the situation. So here you could see the two molecules, they are essentially catalysts for certain organic transformations. Now, these two molecules are very identical in nature, except in one case, you could see the diamine fragment over here, which is synaptin fragment, which is called bion. And in other situation, the same diamine fragment, which is at the backbone, you will be getting the phenanthrene fragment. Okay, otherwise the rest, both the molecules are almost identical. Now, if we utilize this molecule for, say, amine oxidation process under a certain, chemical consideration in presence of tempo and molecular oxygen, what we do see that in case of bion-derived compound, it gives us double dehydrogenated product, that means nitrile. On the other hand, if we go for the phenanthrene-derived product, it gives us your basically transamination product. Now the question comes up, what factor control this switchable reactivity under identical reaction conditions? Okay, to understand that situation, we need to go back to the electronic configurations of these two molecules. If we see this bion-derived molecule, the bion-derived molecule undergoes very facile successive reduction processes, and it can accept up to 4 electrons, the first 2 electrons at the diamine fragment and the second and third at the naphthene fragment. On the other hand, if we go to the phenanthrene fragment, then the successive 2 electron reduction could be possible at this diamine fragment, but irreversibly, and the potential is much higher negatively compared to the bion fragment. This facile reduction process of bion essentially helps us to differentiate their reactivity pattern. How it is so? It is a very difficult process. In the next slide, if you go, next slide. Now, if you try to understand their catalytic features, how it is being happening. So if we keep all the aspects aside, what we believe in, that this particular catalyst in presence of tempo and molecular oxygen, it undergoes the amine attacks at the metal center, and that undergoes beta hydride elimination to give that imine, and that imine again reacts in presence of tempo and molecular oxygen to give us the nitrile. Okay, on the other hand, if you go for the phenanthrene-derived catalyst, we do see only one step. That means the amine binds to the metal center and which undergoes the beta hydride elimination to give that imine and subsequently the transamination process. Question is why for the phenanthrene-derived catalyst, only one step of amine attack takes place. Imine does not attack to the metal center as it is being observed in case of bion-derived catalyst. The reason is very obvious that in case of bion-derived catalyst, because of the facile reduction process of the ligand, then this compound could be better described through its resonating form, that means metal 2 neutral ligand and metal 3 radical ligand. That means the intramolecular electron transfer, which is being feasible in this case. And as a matter of fact, this metal has become reasonably more electrophilic and which allows the second amine to interact, that does not occur over here because of the fact of the unfavorable reduction steps of the phenylserine derived ligand. So what I'm trying to convey through this particular example, that if under a favorable circumstances where the Fontrier orbitals of the metal and ligand, they are close to each other, then intramolecular electron transfer facilitates, and as a matter of fact, the electrophilicity of the metal center gets altered, and which allows the second molecule of the imine to attack at the metal center and leads to a different product compared to the other catalyst under the similar experimental conditions because of the fact the unfavorable situations of the redox over there. Now the next slide, another example which we would like to highlight, very interesting example. Now, if you see this particular ligand, which is considered to be one of the well-known bridging ligand, now which is called 2,2-pyridyl analog. Now, if this R could be oxygen, or R could be the NR, that means the imine fragment. Now, if you react this particular bridge with one says very selective metal fragment, here we have considered ruthenium acetyl acetonate 2 best metal fragment. And then in case of imine product, we get the expected dinuclear compound in a diastereomeric form, which could be structurally analyzed, etc., etc., and a very stable compound. Nothing happens to this compound. On the other hand, if you take the oxygen variety, then what happens? Under if you use the bottle toluene, the way which is being used for the imine, we don't see any product of this. Instead, we get one picolinate-based compound. On the other hand, if you use the dry toluene, then under the identical reaction conditions, then we get the dinuclear compound as in the case of the imine-based bridge. But the problem is this compound spontaneously undergoes oxygenation process, and that actually it facilitates the carbon-carbon bond cleavage, and with the activation of molecular oxygen, and it gives the picolinate product. Question is, why this difference is just by switching from oxygen to the NR group? Okay, in order to understand this thing, we need to do a little bit of calculations. Next slide, please. Now, in the calculation, if you see little bit carefully, that the LUMO of the oxygenated ligand, which is much lower compared to the imine-based ligand, okay? And that tells us very clearly that the oxygen-based ligand, that means if X equal to oxygen, then it can have a tautomeric form. That means intramolecular electron transfer can take place, the two electron metal oxidations, which is being compensated by the two electron reduction over there. And as a result, the singlet and triplet, that equilibrium exists in case of oxygen-based ligand, and that could be analyzed theoretically. And you see that singlet and triplet gap is only 700 centimeter inverse, whereas in case of imine derivative, which is around 5,000 centimeter inverse. Okay, almost 10 times one could think about. So it is very likely that this tautomeric form cannot persist in case of your oxygen-based, imine-based ligand system, okay? Now, if it is the fact that the tautomeric form exhibits or exists over there and which takes part in the selective carbon-carbon bond cleavage process, then how to understand it? So there are two ways one could think about. Now, conventionally, if you see the inorganic chemistry literature, all the time or most of the times you find that oxygen reacts at the metal center, mostly in the copper chemistry or iron chemistry. Oxygen reacts at the metal center, and that oxygen gets transformed via some other alternate mechanism over there. Now, in our case, we cannot think about that oxygen is straightaway reacting to the metal center because of the fact where we have taken the coordinatively saturated situation, And if we considered oxygen is reacting to the metal center, which is a likely situation, and there one could expect to have the, you know, superoxide based compound. But the problem, as I said, the 7 coordinated intermediate, which does not sustain even in calculation. So alternatively, one could think about that oxygen is a triplet molecule, so it only reacts with the, you know, molecule with the open cell configuration. So if we consider this particular tautomeric form, that means the triplet situation, then oxygen can react over here, and which can give us the dioxin intermediate. And then it undergoes, you know, oxygen-oxygen bond cleavage, carbon-carbon bond cleavage. So, and at the end, we get that product, which is called the picolinate derivative. So this particular example, it shows multiple operational factors over here. One is that molecular oxygen could be activated, first point, and that activation is feasible or possible if one think about the tautomeric form of the starting molecule, and tautomeric form is possible if the, you know, energy level of that particular metal and ligand, they are close to each other through intramolecular electron transfer process. And if that is not feasible, for example, in the case of the imine analog, and it does not sustain, and one could easily get the impression through the difference between singlet and triplet, that energy gap. Okay, so both the processes tells us very clearly that the redox-induced metal ligand cooperativity can lead to have the molecular functionation, or in other word, that one could think about the chemical non-innocence of the substrate, which could not have been possible without this redox participation at the interface. Now go to the next slide. Now with this background, we thought to bring into one very interesting example. Now, this is from the organic point of view. All of you know this is beta-diketimidate. Now, this beta-diketimidate ligand system, it has this long history, and most of the cases in coordination chemistry particularly, people have used in 3-4 directions this particular ligand on coordination, because in a free condition, this ligand is hopeless. It does not do anything mostly. But on metallation condition, it undergoes substrate activation processes. For example, there are many examples are known, mostly at the first transitions or main group level, that this can undergo the hydrogenation at this C-beta nucleophilic center. It can react with a lot of dinucleophiles and gives us the cycloaddition reactions. If we can make one coordinatively unsaturated molecular setup, then it activates the small molecules like oxygen, nitrosyl, or dinitrogen, etc., etc. And one more important features of this molecule, it exhibits hidden non-innocence. So non-innocence means, in terms of redox, what we can say, that the molecule can have more than one redox states. So it can behave like transition metals, right? That is called the redox active setup. Now, if we take the analogous diamine fragment, so this is your diamine-based ligand if you consider, what we see, the nodal planes are along the bonds. And as a result, any change in redox takes us to the fact of the diagonistic change in the bond order or metric parameters. So by following the structural features or the metric parameters, one could talk about its redox states, etc., etc. But in case of diamine fragment, the difficulty is the nodal planes are essentially along the atoms. And as a result, we don't see any diagonistic feature in terms of metric parameters with the, as a function of the change in redox. So it's much more difficult to follow if some redox participation of this kind of diamine beta-diketimidate ligand takes place over there. But there are alternate ways always if there are difficulties. So one needs to follow through EPR technique that would help us to understand, or through detailed calculations. So if we put all these things together, we can still understand that how the redox things come into the picture as far as the beta diketaminate is concerned, what is conventionally known as NAC-NAC. Now, next slide. So, in order to understand the activity of this particular ligand, we have prepared a very simple compound. This compound is no way interesting. Okay, on tree skillet, if you look at this compound, and all three negative charges, so metal gets stabilized in the plus three state. But what happens that this compound, once you isolate it, either in the solid state or in solution state, if you leave it for a few minutes, immediately the color has got changed. And if you analyze these products, then we could see that oxygenation takes place at the C beta site, which has not been observed ever. Okay, and this oxygenation takes us to the beta, basically ketodiimine fragment, which could be analyzed structurally and otherwise also. Okay, next slide. And this transformation process, that means oxygenation process, could be easily elaborated through kinetic experiment, and it tells very clearly the delta H, delta S values, that it's an associatively activated process. Now, next slide. How this oxygenation takes place? In order to understand the mechanistic aspect of the oxygenation process, one needs to understand the electronic structural aspects of this precursor compound. Is it truly a metal 3 anionic ligand-based compound or something else? If you see the ESR profile of this compound and D anisotropy value very clearly, then it tells us it is essentially metal in the 3 state, but not exactly in 100% sense. Otherwise, it would have been 2.1. That is the average value one could think about as far as the ruthenium 3 low spin configuration is concerned. Now, if you see the spin density of this doublet-based compound, we see the 20% spin at the C beta site and 70% spin at the metal site. That does indicate that one particular electronic configuration is not enough to describe this molecule. Rather, a resonating form would be preferred, and in that case, the minority contribution would be metal in the 2 and ligand at the radical state. That means intramolecular electron transfer takes place over here. And this configuration, around 20%, now the question is, this 20% configuration of the radical would be enough to understand the oxygenation process or not. If you go to the next slide, what do we see? That from the organic perspective, one could think about this reaction in two different mechanisms. I'm talking in terms of the students, that one simple way to look at the anionic pathway, but the difficulty of consideration of anionic pathway over here, that the molecule where the activity takes place or oxygenation takes place, that C beta site, this is actually a closed cell system. And our molecule oxygen, which is your triplet situation, so that is not allowed. That reaction should not take place. On the other hand, oxygenation can take place at the metal center because there is an unpaired spin over here. But it is hexacoordinated, so there is no question of oxygen incorporation at the metal center. That would take us to the 7 coordinated system, and which does not sustain. So still one could think about the under the crystal field impact, it is known that triplet oxygen could also be transformed into the singlet oxygen, and if it is so, hypothetically, and that singlet oxygen can attack over here, it takes us to the peroxo intermediate, followed by hydroperoxo, followed by the desired product. Okay, but this is, to me, it's a very unlikely situation considering the energy factor. It's an energetically uphill process, but one cannot completely rule out unless one is having the experimental fact in against of it. So the alternate consideration, if we think about or accept the fact of the previous case, that it's not a purely metal 3 anionic ligand, it's essentially a minority contribution of the resonating form where the radical ligand is also a likely situation. Though it is a 20%, but still one cannot rule out the role of this radical component towards the oxygenation process. And if it is so, hypothetically, then oxygen can easily react with this radical center, and then it gives us the superoxo intermediate, followed by hydroperoxo, this hydrogen transfer, followed by the product. Now, this is very nice to write on a piece of paper, but how to establish the fact that this reaction is following this pathway rather than energetically uphill this process? Yes, if we look at this experimental fact, that EPR of this particular starting material, if you look at the G anisotropy is 0.314, and we could isolate this intermediate, superoxo intermediate, though very reactive, and then we see the G anisotropy is 0.046, almost 10 times, you know, 0.3 and 0.04. It's essentially the radical based EPR with partial metal delocalization, and spin density, if you see, it is essentially at this C beta site. So superoxo intermediate through the reaction is moving. Next. Now, if we accept the experimental fact, we are very clear that the reaction is falling to the radical intermediate via the mediation of your resonating formulation. But if we change that, you know, precursor, you know, your peripheral ligand by acetyl, from acetyl acetonate to bipyridine, which is a very strong pi acceptor ligand, and then there is no question of resonating form over here. It is a perfectly S equal to zero system, and there is no alternate Ru3 radical setup is possible at all because of the pi acceptor nature over here. And if this compound is exposed to the molecular oxygen or atmospheric oxygen, we see that again the oxygenation takes place. But this rate of oxygenation is much slower. If in the previous case, it is in the tune of minutes, but it is in the tune of hours. It takes almost one day for complete transformations. Now, how do you interpret the mechanistic aspects of this oxygenation process? Naturally, we cannot grow through the radical-based mechanism. Here, we have no option. We have to go by the, you know, anionic pathway. That means what we have considered as an unlikely situation in the previous case because of the fact of the existence of the radical situation over there. Here, we have no option other than to consider the same option, that the influence of the crystal field, which allows the, in between transformation of a triplet oxygen to a singlet oxygen, and then which attacks at the C beta site, gives that peroxo intermediate, and the reaction follows. And if you carefully check the HOMO of this particular ligand, here we see the C beta site actually dominating. That means almost 60% composition and a contribution coming from the C beta side. So it's a likely situation to form the peroxo intermediate and so on. So one cannot rule out the transformation of singlet or triplet oxygen to singlet oxygen via the influence of the crystal field. Okay, next slide. So in order to understand this fact, we then modified the compound to a certain extent. Instead of bipyridine, now we have gone to the azopyridine. And azopyridine is considered to be the strongest possible pi acceptor chelating ligand. Okay. And there we see no oxygenation even in the tune of week or month. And why it is so? Little bit of calculation helps us to understand the strong pi acceptor feature. It stabilizes the HOMO for this compound compared to the bipyridine compound to a large extent. As a matter of fact, the reacting LUMO of the oxygen, the gap has been increased from 48 kilocalorie to almost 56 kilocalorie, and which does not allow any kind of oxygenation process at the C beta site under that particular molecular framework consideration. Okay. Next question comes into the picture. If the radical at the C beta site on coordination is so important, then what we have noticed for up to 20% radical contribution, which takes us to the oxygenation process almost immediately. What happens if we design or redesign that NACNAC ligand in such a way where if you could introduce the more amount of radical feature, does the oxidation rate enhances or not? That was the question in our mind. So we modified this NACNAC ligand, this is the conventional NACNAC ligand, to a BHM, that means B-heterocyclic methanide, and with the hope or with the anticipation that the radical contribution would be enhancing over here. Now the two such BHM we have considered, one is the bridgehead nitrogen derived compound, which is in the diamine form, or other one is the sulfur derived, which is called immunoenamine form. Okay, this could be synthesized in a conventional sense. And here it is a bridgehead nitrogen is here. So we anticipate that this would pump in the electron at the C beta side, and this should exhibit much stronger radical feature compared to this one, the previous one, the original one, and also the modified sulfur-based one. Next slide. Then he thought to make a direct comparison as far as the oxygenation is concerned in order to validate our proposition. The radical plays a very significant role over here. So what we did, the three compounds we have taken, if you look at, this is the original NACNAC, this is your BHM, and this is your sulfur-based BHM. And the rate of oxygenation all could be structurally characterized. I'm talking about the product, starting material, both. Now, if we see the oxygenation rate under identical reaction conditions, that bridgehead nitrogen-containing BHM, which is tenfold higher compared to the original NACNAC one, first one, and second one, the sulfur-based, which is, you know, rate is greater than your original one, but much smaller than or slower than your bridgehead nitrogen containing BHM. Now the question is why? If we see the next slide, then the starting compounds, if we compare these three starting compounds, we see the first one, the original NACNAC, and the third one, the sulfur-based BHM. If you look at the EPR spectrum profile, it suggests the primary configuration is Ru3NL-. But if you look at this particular compound where the rate is much faster, it is basically the radical-based EPR. That means Ru2 dot, that is the primary configuration. And if you see the spin density distribution, in case of original NACNAC, metal ligand ratio 80-20 roughly, and in case of the other one almost similar, but in case of the middle one you see the reverse pattern, 80% spin at the ligand side and 20% spin at the metal side. So what is happening, by slight modification at the backbone of the NACNAC ligand, we could completely alter their electronic configuration. Earlier it was dominated, the spin was dominated at the metal side. Now in this particular case, spin is dominating at the ligand side. And when the radical contribution at the ligand side is maximum, so the rate of oxygenation is maximum. So therefore it justifies the fact what we said in the previous case. Let's go into the next slide. And then what do we see? That the reaction proceeds through the superoxo intermediate, followed by hydroperoxo, followed by oxygenated product. And this intermediate could be again established by variety of experimental fact like mass, you go to the next slide, oxygen labeling, then between these two, if you compare the transition state and intermediate, we see the bridgehead nitrogen containing that product in every step, which is energetically favorable in case of transition state, intermediate, transition state, even the product. Okay, this is much more favorable than this one. So the rate of oxygenation is much faster over here. So the next slide, then if we go to the resonance Raman, both the cases which justifies the fact of the superoxo formation. This is the characteristic position of the metal superoxo, carbon-based superoxo position. And then mass, Fukui indices, parameters, everything are in place to justify the radical based mechanism as we have already established in case of the original knack-knack followed by the modified knack-knack. Okay, next slide. Well, when you are dealing with this knack-knack system and oxygenation process, what people have not seen it earlier due to whatever the reasons, but we could manage to see it, this one. Then he thought, is it very selective for the heavier metal, particularly the metal which is very redox active, say ruthenium one, or it is a generic scenario? So we thought to begin with the two fast transition derived metal fragment. We use the copper and zinc, and we know very well that in the copper and zinc case, redox is not zinc case, so there is no question of redox. Copper case, redox could take place, but not as facile as in case of ruthenium setup. What we surprisingly observed that if you react this, then instead of any oxygenation under oxygen environment, this radical decombination takes place over here. That means the carbon-carbon bond formation takes place in both the cases. Then we went into a lot of experimental thing, a lot of theoretical calculations, etc., etc. We realized the fact that once we have introduced, because BHM has the bridged, derived BHM. BHM has the general tendency to pump the electron at the C beta site and to make it a radical, particularly on metal coordination, independently the metal redox. Okay, that we understood. And if it is so, then the concern is oxygenation rate versus the radical decombination rate. And we have calculated and experimentally established the fact that if we use the lighter element where the radical decombination rate, I'm talking about this radical decombination rate, which is much, much faster compared to the oxygenation rate. And that takes us to the fact of a competitive scenario between the oxygenation versus CC coupling process. Again, we are trying to emphasize the fact that how redox can influence the functionalization based on the fact of the metal ligand participation. Okay, of course, we have not published this work so far. Now go to the next slide. Now, this slide, if we see it, we asked certain questions. The question was that if we use the knack-knack, either in a symmetric or asymmetric, this is the unsymmetric knack-knack, oxygenation we have already seen over here. Now if you change this nitrogen by this oxygen or sulfur, what we call ACNAC and this is SACNAC. Normally or apparently one could anticipate that they would behave more or less similarly or identically. But in chemistry, we know until and unless we perform the processes, we should not be dare enough to predict much. We must try to predict something. Many times it works and many times it does not also work. This is one of the cases where we could see some similar observations. For example, if you take this particular knack-knack situation, that means oxygen equal to NH, we get oxygenation product. It is nothing uncommon or nothing unusual because we have already observed this scenario. If you go for the sulfur derived, SACNAC, what do we see? No oxygenation at all. We tried our best, but it never been oxygenated. This position somehow with the sulfur, it remains absolutely robust. Nothing happens. But also we get one product where the carbon-sulfur bond cleavage takes place and it ended up to the mu3-HB's trinuclear system with a lot of other variations are there. Of course, we had published this thing long back, so we did not concentrate much on it here. But the main message is that SACNA cannot be oxygenated. But if you take the ACNAC, that means oxygen variety, what happens? We get purely, you know, unreactive product. That means the ACNAC, like SACNAC, cannot take part into the reaction. But in addition to this product, we could get another product in a fairly good yield where you could see the C beta could be acetylated. So far we have been talking about the oxygenation at the C beta site, but when you move into the ACNAC is a useless, nothing happens over there. But if you go for the ACNAC case, instead of oxygenation, we could manage to see the acetylation. So there are two questions over here. Why the behavior is like this? Why this kind of abrupt behavior just by moving from nitrogen center to oxygen center to sulfur center? First point. Second point, if we try to understand the acetylation at the C beta site, then what we try to do, that whether this could be transformed into this or not, we checked it, there is no transformation. This is absolutely stable compound. It happened independently. Well, let us try to answer that question. Go to the next slide. Now, if you go to the next slide, next slide, all could be structurally characterized. Interestingly, you see that this is the NACNAC, this is the SACNAC, and this is the ACNAC. In all the cases, metal is essentially at the plus 3 state. Right, you must have noticed that thing. And plus 3 means it is a T2G5 low spin 1 unpaired electron. And if you look at the EPR features, particularly I'm trying to draw your attention at the G anisotropic parameters. The G anisotropic parameters for NACNAC, it is much smaller than the ACNAC case and also smaller than the SACNAC. So larger G anisotropy means the more metal character, which is the common understanding, right? And the lower G anisotropy means the lower metal character at the, you know, SOMO, singly occupied molecular orbital level. Now, if we do the calculations, all the three, SACNAC, ACNAC, and NACNAC, we see that 20% around or 22% around spin at the, as already we have said beforehand, the spin at the C beta site. In case of SACNAC, we do see slightly lower than 0.17%. Okay, you know, we have done this calculation in different, you know, basis set function, and there is a kind of, you know, similarity. 0.17, and if you go to the ACNAC, virtually nothing, and it is the least one. Okay, so here oxygenation takes place. This is nothing takes place, and here also nothing takes place as far as the oxygenation is concerned. Because we have been vouching the fact so far that oxygenation at the C beta site, the primary requirement is the spin density at that C beta site. If we can pump in spin at the selectively at the C beta site, more electron density at the C beta site would facilitate the oxygenation process. But in this particular series, with the NACNAC, not BHM, with the NACNAC, we see the slight difference in spin density at this position, nothing much, because here itself, initially, it is only 20%. And if you lower that, then there is no oxygenation. And that could be, you know, somehow correlated using the EPR deanisotropy. But more or less, the message what I am trying to say, the slight variation of spin density could lead to remarkable difference in reactivity profile as far as the C beta is concerned. And it does, again, re-emphasize the fact that the oxygenation profile at the C beta site, which is a very sensitive factor towards its spin density or towards its electronic density at that point. Okay, so that's a nicely one could think about it. Now, as I said, the acetylation cannot be taken place from the unreactive to the that site. Okay, there is no conversion. So one could believe, the way we try to understand this mechanistic aspect, that the free ACNAC in the system, which might have participated in the reaction to a certain, you know, direction to lead to the product. So what is our understanding is that the the free NH function of the free ligand, which actually initially form on hydrogen bonding scenario with the metal center, which increases the electrophilicity at the C alpha position of the free ACNAC, and that reacts with the C beta site of the coordinated ACNAC, and that takes us the enaminate intermediate, which could be detected by mass, followed by the standard reactions, and in presence of base, we get the product. Now, question is, this consideration, what is the experimental justification? Yes, we try to follow this reaction kinetically. It could indeed be followed kinetically. Now, what we have observed, that this R group, AR group, if we increase the, you know, electron withdrawing group at the AR fragment, like chloride, HOME to this sequence, if we follow, we see the rate enhances by introducing the electron withdrawing group, which in other word, it justifies the fact of the more electrophilicity, okay, had led to the facile, you know, nucleophilic attack at the C beta site. Okay, this is how we felt the amphiphilic character of ACNAC. Okay, now the next slide, again the question which comes in our mind, that SACNAC, somehow we could not activate it, so the story is not complete over here. Hopefully sometime tomorrow or day after we could address that SACNAC issue, which looks to me as a difficult issue, but one could perhaps solve it. But if you take the ACNAC, because oxygen sulfur is always peculiar, so one could understand it. Huh? So that's we have not taken up the sulfur so far. Now, oxygen and nitrogen, they have some kind of friendship. Okay, this is my understanding. Electronegativity wise and otherwise, size wise, etc. So they generally behave, with certain degree of parity. But as far as the ACNAC and NACNAC, towards that oxidation process, they behave diagonally oppositely. In one case, it is so facile, other case, hopeless. So the question came up, is it always hopeless or we have been missing something somewhere? To address that issue, then we came up with a different molecular framework. Now, what we have done over here is a very simple thing. Instead of one, ACNAC, we have made the bis ACNAC with same compound along with the acetyl acetonate peripheral or ancillary ligand. So earlier case, the two ACNAC or ACAC was there and one ACNAC or NACNAC, whatever it is. Now here we have gone for two ACNAC case. And if you go for this particular, donor combinations, then you can expect to have three isomeric configurations, and we could indeed achieve to get all the three isomers. All could be structurally characterized, and then we tried to follow their oxygenation process. What we have noticed again, that out of these three isomeric form, only this particular CTC isomeric form, which could participate in oxygenation process, but in a very selective way, that one particular ACNAC could be oxygenated, particularly at our hand. I don't know what will happen to others' hand. One particular ACNAC could be oxygenated. So it tells us one particular issue, and it raises one particular question. The issue is, what we thought previously, the ACNAC is equally nonsense like SACNAC. But with certain caution in mind, because nitrogen, oxygen, some kind of similarities are there. So it proves no, ACNAC is not inert. It can be oxygenated, but one needs to have the necessary coordination situation. That's the beauty of inorganic chemistry at a small molecular level. So necessary coordination situation, if someone can introduce, then that apparently impossible situation could be converted into some kind of feasibility. And that essentially did happen over here. That is the first part. Second part, why this isomer? Okay. Because that answer we tried to get through theory, but we could not reach to a point where we wanted to. But what you could see that the isomer where, if you look at carefully, the nitrogen center of the ACNAC trans to the electron-rich oxygen ACAC, here it is not so. Both the nitrogens of both the ACNAC, where they are trans to electron-rich ACAC moiety, ACAC oxygen, they are only that is being taken place. And then some calculation suggests that here to activate it, a minimum level of electron density is needed. In the previous case, we have shown when we made the comparison between ACNAC, ACNAC and SACNAC, so 0.22 is fine, but 0.17 is not fine, 0.11 is not fine. But the slight variation, that means there is a critical need of electron density. If it goes below that, no oxygenation. But if you can increase it, certainly the rate would be enhanced. That is being observed in case of BHM, what we have already talked about. Here also, we can extrapolate the similar ideas. A bare minimum electron density is needed. And that is what it is being happening over here. It is being made over here, not in the other case. And that is being facilitated through the geometrical disposition, as I have already said. Now, one could argue, if it is so, then why it is not being happening to the second ACNAC case? But then you require to have electron hopping process, right? An electron hopping process is not a likely scenario as far as the ACNAC is concerned. Okay, and that is why possibly it hasn't been taken place so far. Next. Next slide, please. Now, I am at the frag end. Okay. So let me conclude based on the title what I have proposed in today's talk, that the redox induced chemical non-innocence of substrate. That means if we want to activate the substrate via the small molecular activation pathway, that could be tuned by the redox participation. If redox is not there, most likely this reaction won't be taken place. So it raises the question, redox is so important? Answer is yes. So thank you very much. Let me acknowledge the funding agencies. And this is my present group. Of course, everybody did not participate in this particular process. Some of them have participated. I would like to acknowledge their contributions. And again, I would like to thank Professor Iyer to invite me to give a talk to share a part of our work, what we have been following in the recent years. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Lahiri, for the excellent lecture and explaining the role of ligands and metals for, I think, you know, various catalytic reactions, and of course also explaining the importance of this, you know, redox pathways. So I try to summarize it very briefly. I'm sure that, you know, there are many more aspects that you covered. So, you know, the talk is open. If there are any questions, I request you all to please go ahead and ask questions. I don't see any questions in YouTube as of now. There are no questions as of now in the YouTube. But anybody else here, you know, if there are any questions, please go ahead. So is there any, you know, I have a general question. Is there any design principle that you follow for, you know, choosing the ligands?
Yeah, of course.
Specific, of course. Yeah, very, very specific. Yes. So,
Because you know the thing is unless you design, you know, you need to do some kind of computational thing beforehand to understand their FMO, the frontier molecular orbital energy levels, and put in the metal. Okay, if they are not very close by, then you cannot expect to have the resonating or tautomeric form. And if they are close by, then through resonating form or through tautomeric form, you can think of the electron shuttling at the intramolecular level, and that actually can take you to the fact of the reactivity.
Any other questions, Professor Pradeep? You have any questions? You have to unmute yourself. You have to unmute yourself. Yes, please go ahead.
Yeah. So I have one simple question. So when you make the imines out of this acetyl acetonate, so what consideration you take for aryl components to choose that aryl components?
You are talking
electron withdrawing like that?
Yeah. It's a large substrate scope we have considered. Okay.
Yeah.
And this reaction is so facile, okay, because the catalytic catalyst is so good. This part is equally applicable to, if you see that those two papers, three papers, they are equally applicable to aromatic, aliphatic, heterocycle, withdrawing, and some variations are there, of course, based on withdrawing or donating and their positions in the aromatic ring as well. Some variations are there, but there is a general approach where it can cover the broader substrate scope. That is the thing one normally looks for, right?
Okay. But do you really see some SecNEC, it is not working at all. So it is completely rigid.
As of now.
Okay. Yes. But for example, for this neck, if you source some certain components in aryl component, certain functionality, can you stop that oxidation process? Is it possible? Because now, whatever I have seen from your lecture,
listen, our target was a little bit one dimensional. Target was to justify the fact of our proposed mechanism. In the initial case, we justified the fact of the superoxo intermediate. And in support of that, we had the evidence of ESR of the superoxo, right? Okay. But one question was always in our mind, we did not have any doubt about the fact. But one question, chemical question was in our mind, that 20% resonating form is so prominent towards the final product formation. So in order to justify that fact, we remodeled the ligand framework where we could reach to the point of 20% to 80%. And there we could see the same mechanism, but with the enhanced rate, almost tenfold enhanced of the rate. We thought to establish the fact or the understanding what we have introduced in the beginning through the modification of the ligands and through the experimental facts or theoretical facts together.
But initial phase, definitely, I think you would not carry out theoretical modeling for choosing the ligand. Am I right?
No. Initially, it was rather accidental. We observed that because nobody did see that kind of oxygenation at the carbon, which is very difficult, I think Professor Iyer would agree, being an organic chemist, how difficult to oxygenate that position. It's nothing simple. So it happened free ligand, nothing happens. It happens only in presence of metal center, which is expected. But you know what happened? People never observed that kind of. They have seen. I have shown already, to react with this thing, that thing, all sort of thing, but not oxygenation. And first we saw it, then we tried to understand it, and then we tried to help ourselves through the molecular modification to feel better. This is how, and that is how the.
That is correct. Yeah. Okay, thank you very much for your nice deliberation. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Pradeep, you know, for being here throughout the lectures. So I think if there are no more questions, you know, on behalf of the three institutes that are organizing this, Professor Narshan is also here. Do you have any questions, Professor Narshan?
Yes,
you are muted. Professor Narshan, you are muted. You have to unmute yourself.
I have unmuted it. So we have listened to two very wonderful lectures, one by Professor Ajay Ghosh and Professor Lahiri, and very really thankful. And many of our participants are being benefited. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Narshan. So we are, you know, three institutes that are organizing this: Guwahati University, Tejpur University, and IIT Guwahati. So on behalf of the three institutes, you know, I take this opportunity to thank you, you know, for sparing your valuable time. It's more than two and a half hours that we are online. And I think all the participants also, we are really thankful. And it was really a wonderful beginning to this Chemistry Week celebration in the CRSI Northeast. Hopefully, when the situation improves, we will also be able to invite you all and visit here. So for the participants, you know, tomorrow we have two more lectures at the same time, 3 to 4:30. So I request you all to please be online tomorrow. So once again, on behalf of the CRSI Northeast chapter, thank you, Professor Ajay Ghosh and Professor Lahiri. It was nice that you all spared time and agreed to our invitation. Thank you. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thanks a lot. All the best.
Thank you.
Take care.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Okay, bye.